all of us begins when we realize that what we have is not enough. That unsettled spirit inside of us causes us to look beyond what we have for our meaning in life. It can be a very uncomfortable process.
Majesty, worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority flows from His throne. His anthem reigns. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King.
His Majesty, let's hear you.
Majesty, worship His Majesty.
guys.
Majesty, kingdom authority flows from his throne unto his own, his anthem reigns. His Majesty, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
So exalt, lift up on high.
So exalt, lift up on high, the name of Jesus. Magnify, God glorify, Christ Jesus the King. Died, now glorified, King of all kings.
This is your final boarding call for Israel 2016. Don't miss out on this amazing experience. Reserve your place now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey, immerse your senses, ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family on a trip of a lifetime. This is your last chance to reserve your spot now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016. Visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. That's 1-877-465-3442.
Israel, Awaken 2016. It's your time.
Almost 500 people traveled together to explore the land where Jesus walked. The journey culminated in a retreat on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, where Charles and Hillary Price shared the message of Jesus Christ. Living Truth is pleased to share this teaching series with you.
There's no better place to think about where we are with Jesus in our walk than this place where Peter began to walk with him. And it might be in your life that you have got to the place that Peter ended up in, where he, the Bible tells us, followed at a distance. And if you've been following at a distance, then it would be really good to come back today. Not at the end of the tour, not when you get home, but today, because these 2 days apart are for a very specific reason, and they're for us to realign our lives with Christ. And so if this afternoon was uncomfortable with you, and if you went and spent time with God and had to admit to him, you know, God, I haven't really been on speaking terms with you for a long time, I hope you heard his welcome. But before we look at this story of Peter, I want to tell you a story. It's one of my favourite little stories because it seems to say so much to me, and it's about a little boy who walked on the same route to school every day. And he'd turn around a corner and walk along a road, and the school was at the end of the road. And one day he walked down the road, which was very familiar to him, and something very unfamiliar was happening. There were two massive blocks of stone that had been placed in front of the gates of a big house, and he was intrigued and he looked. He thought, that's very interesting, but he had to get to school. He walked on by. He came back that night, and there they were in place, shuffled into the right place that they were intended for. So the next day he came, and now he saw some men chipping away at the stone. He thought, oh, that's very interesting. And day after day he would walk past, and they'd be chipping away at the stone. And he couldn't linger because he was going to school. And then it was time for his summer break, and the men had just been chipping away. And so he stopped walking along that road to school for a couple of months. And then term started again. It was time for him to go back to school. And as he came to the corner that he was about to go round, he was listening for the chipping of the stone. And there was no chipping of the stone. He walked round the corner, and to his amazement, in place of the big block of stone was a lion. And the sculptor had just finished, and he was standing by the lion, and the little boy ran up to him and he said, oh, he's amazing. How did you know he was in there? How did you know he was in there? And you know, God is the only person who knows who's inside you. His eyes saw your unformed body. So when he looks, he's looking for the person he made that has might have got buried beneath the layers of stuff that's happened in our lives. But he knows who he's looking for, and he knows who he made us to be so he could continue to chip away and mold us and make us. And many of you did the study on the vine, and the vine never grows without pruning. Painful as that is, God knows what he's doing with our lives and what he's aiming for. I hope you've still got your Bibles with you. If you turn to John chapter 1, verses 33 to 43, I'm not going to read them all to you, but in these verses, we're told how Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, had met Jesus and he went to find his brother. Most of us were simply brought to Christ by an Andrew. We don't hear an awful lot of Andrew, but we do hear a lot about the person he brought to Christ, and that was his role, to bring Simon Peter to Christ. And when he did so, we're told in verse 42 of John chapter 1, then he brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which when translated is Peter. I hope you circle things or mark things in your Bible, but if you do, circle the word are. You are Simon, you will be Peter. Our lives are all about moving from you are to you will be. And Jesus, it tells us, looked at him. He looked at him. And the words used in that verse for he looked at him are the same words used for the look that passed between Peter and Jesus when Jesus was being flogged and tried in those places we saw in Jerusalem. And Peter denied him, and Jesus passed by and looked at Peter, the same word. Jesus is very keen to maintain eye contact with us, but he can't do it if we continually look away from him. And Peter came to a place where he followed at a distance and he did not look into the face of Christ. And so the journey from who you are to who you will be, and who I am and who I will be, has many ups and downs and highs and lows and joys and sorrows and successes and failures and delights and disappointments and pains and pleasures. And it was no different for Peter. He knew all these things, and Peter's quite unusual amongst the disciples. Peter is the only disciple who ever says no to Jesus. I don't know if you realize that. But no isn't the end of the story, because Jesus doesn't just accept the no. But Peter is honest enough to say no. Peter's the first disciple to worship Jesus. Peter's the first disciple to confess his sinfulness to Jesus. Peter's the only disciple who ever tried to walk on water. He's the only disciple who succeeded to walk on water because he's the only disciple who tried to walk on water. Peter had a real relationship with Jesus. He was a fisherman. Peter was in a fisherman in this part of the world where pork was not eaten. And therefore, there was a great demand for fish, so I'm guessing he was pretty busy. He was a married man, he was an ordinary man, going about his ordinary business in this very ordinary place when his life and Jesus' life intersected. I want you to turn to Luke chapter 5. We have the account of this meeting on the shore. Verse 1. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, which is also Galilee, with the people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and he asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and we haven't caught anything," just to humour him, "but because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signalled their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats, so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. I'm sure you have read this passage and thought, how amazing. Who would drop everything and follow Jesus just like that? Well, not Peter. This is not the first time that Peter has met Jesus. He's already met him, as we saw in John chapter 1, after Jesus had been baptized at the River Jordan. He'd been found by Jesus and he had followed Jesus. He had watched him. He had listened to his teaching. Jesus had been to his home. He had healed his mother-in-law. But Peter, when he encounters Jesus on the shore in his world, is still a fisherman fishing for fish. And it's time to respond to Jesus' call and invitation to surrender and become a fisher of men. So why did Peter decide to make this decision? Why did he decide to leave his nets? Nets can be very time-consuming. I think, sadly, a lot of us have spent our whole life cleaning our nets and beautifying our boats, and we've never actually left them. And in this tiny little passage, so many things happen that begin the process for Simon Peter of moving from "you are" to "you will be." And it might simply be in your life you have never moved from who you are to who you will be because you're still so busy cleaning your nets. So preoccupied. You are. There are so many things in Simon Peter's life that could have stopped him becoming a disciple. They would have stopped him if he had believed what many of us have falsely believed today, that you are what you own, you are what you've got, and you are what you do. How big your car is, how big your house is. Peter has got a lot that could have prevented him walking along the beach that day with Jesus. He's got a brother, he's got a wife, he's got a mother-in-law, he's got a house, he's got a boat, he's got a job. He's got many of the things that we've all got. He has a family. But I don't know if you noticed, Peter let Jesus get into what he'd got before he left it. He allowed Jesus to get into the boat. The boat is the center of his world. It's where he functions from every day. He allowed him to come into his home. He had actually healed his mother-in-law. But despite the success, seemingly, of Peter's life, of all his possessions and all he has and all he does, he's not that successful. He's got limits and things aren't perfect. And we know that because they've toiled all night and caught nothing. It's not as though his business is all amazing. And probably deep down, he's frustrated with what he's got and he's frustrated with what he's good at and it doesn't always work for him. And faith in all of us begins when we realize that what we have is not enough. That unsettled spirit inside of us causes us to look beyond what we have for our meaning in life. It can be a very uncomfortable process. What we have is not enough. I have not got what it takes. And Jesus says, I have. I've got what it takes. Put your nets out into deep water. Go out into the deep water and put down your nets. In other words, stop hugging the shoreline. Are you hugging the shoreline because you feel safe there and comfortable there? Go out into the deep water. Some of you tried this afternoon. I saw you wading up to your knees. It was easier here, I think. I didn't get in the water than it was at the Dead Sea. Go out into the deep water. And I don't know what part of your life, or maybe your whole life, God is saying to you, go out into the deep. It might be in your relationships. It might be in your marriage. It might be in your friendships, where you're living at an incredibly superficial level. And Jesus is saying, go out into the deep. Get away from the shore where your feet are resting on the firm soil. Push out into the deep. It might be in your walk with God in church. It might be that God's calling you into a much deeper discipleship. He wants you maybe to teach a Sunday school class or a Bible study. You say, I can't do that. I'll just hug the shore. I'll sit in the class where it's all safe. There might be many areas in our lives where God is saying, go out into the deep, do as I tell you, and then watch what I do. And he simply asks us to take one step. This is Peter's first step, go out into the deep. And if Peter hadn't taken this step, even begrudgingly, because you say so, he probably would never have taken any other steps. We saw that, those of us who are in Egypt, if Moses hadn't turned aside to look at the burning bush, he probably never would have heard anything else from God. And Peter took one step, and he had absolutely no idea where this road was going to lead him to, and actually it led him to crucifixion. We're told that Peter, by tradition, was crucified upside down. It led him all the way through Acts to Rome. And it began here on this shore. One step led to another step, which led to another step. And it was on this shore that Peter discovered what was to be the guiding principle of his life. It's in verse 5. Jesus commands him and he simply says, because you say so, I will. Because you say so. And from this moment onwards, his life is drawn by Jesus. Because you say so, I will step in. We're going to look in a moment at the time when Peter was in a boat and Jesus said to him, come. And we hear the same words, because you say so. He steps out of the boat. And because Jesus says so, he pushes out into the deep. We sing that lovely song, Trust and Obey, for there's no other way. There is no other way. Those two go hand in hand. You cannot say I'm trusting God when you're not obeying him. You cannot obey him without trusting him. And Peter trusts him, he pushes out into the deep and he sees the biggest catch of his life. And because Jesus says so, he walks away from it. He walks away from success and he falls on his knees. And he's already admitted that he's failed as a fisherman. He had to show that to Jesus. I've not done very well catching the fish tonight. And now he has to admit, it's not about just what I do, Jesus, that I feel uncomfortable around you. It's about who I am, and I am a sinner. And when you come close to me, I know that. And he says, go away from me. As Isaiah said, woe is me, for I am a man of unclean lips. And Jesus doesn't need to say anything to make us aware of our sin. He just needs to be his wonderful, pure, majestic, sinless self around us. And through his closeness and his presence, we very quickly become aware of the darkness in us, in the light of his light. And Peter, as Jesus gets closer to him, says to him, go away from me. But of course, Jesus isn't going anywhere. He's not going anywhere without Peter, because now Peter is to be part of his task force. And he's calling Peter to himself. He's not calling him to a project. He's calling him simply to himself. And he's longing for Peter to step into the process and stay in the process. And there's a little test going on here. Stop hugging the shore, put out into the deep, cast the nets. There's lots of obedience happening here, and it's just little by little by little that Peter shows to Jesus, I'm willing to do this. And what I love about Jesus is that he understands Peter's fear. He says to him in verse 10, do not be afraid. He's doing this thing. He's actually obeying in fear. And Jesus knows that about us. Do not be afraid. I've said, I will make you fishers of men. And Peter's probably thinking, what if we never catch anything? What if we... From now on, you will catch men. He hasn't even spoken out his fear, but Jesus has sensed it, he verbalizes it, and he reassures him. Don't be afraid, Peter. From now on, you will catch men. And he identifies in Peter, and he identifies in all of us, when fear is holding us back from coming into a full relationship with him, from stepping into all that God has planned for us, from allowing him to keep chipping away to discover that lion within. Let me read to you something Michael Card wrote. He wrote a beautiful book on the life of Peter called A Fragile Stone. You might know Michael Card as a singer, but this is one of the most beautiful books I've ever read on the life of Peter, A Fragile Stone. And he says this, in response to the miraculous catch, Peter asks for what he really does not want. He asks for Jesus to leave. He has become the frightened fish, thrashing in the net, wanting only to get away, or at least for Jesus to get away from him. Peter has come face to face with the frightening possibility of complete success. Failure, like their earlier empty net, seems so much safer and predictable. That is an incredibly profound statement. A lot of us are happier failing than stepping into success. I have a child who got into that place where actually failure was more comfortable and success seemed so impossible that he was terrified of it. Card goes on. We will see later that often in the presence of Peter, when Jesus reveals his true nature in a new way, the first words from his lips are, don't be afraid. When he calms the storm, when he walks on the water, when he's transfigured, when he's raised from the dead, each time Jesus comforts and calms Peter with these words, don't be afraid. In each instance, when the veil is momentarily lifted and Peter has a terrifying realization that he, a veteran sinner, is in the presence of undiminished deity, it totally undoes him. And indeed it should. Have you ever come close enough to be terrified by the glory of Jesus? Card asked. Have you ever? Have you ever known this fear because you're so aware of the glory of Jesus? And have you ever been willing to trust the one that you fear first before you have faith in him? Peter says, leave me. And Jesus says, no, leave your nets. Leave your nets. And that's not an easy thing to do. Peter's nets represent his security. They are the tools of his trade. They are the means of his income. They preoccupy him every day, mending them, cleaning them, giving them constant attention. Does this ring any bells in your life? I wonder what your nets are. I wonder what fills and preoccupies your life and entangles you in your life. Joe Stoll says, followers are netless believers. Are you a netless believer? A net is anything that inhibits or prohibits our non-negotiated commitment to follow Christ. I wonder what you're clinging to, or what is clinging to you, where you find your identity and everybody around you knows how fantastic your nets are. But you know that you've become completely entangled in them and there's no life beyond the nets. It might be your job, it might be your family, it might be your career, it might be your ambition, it might be your religion, which is squeezing the life out of you because it's not a real relationship. I'm going to give you time tomorrow to identify your nets. There are times when Jesus does not call us away from our nets. He just steps right into the middle of them all. We're not all called to leave home. He got into Peter's boat before he called him out of his boat. And it might simply be that you need to let him into your boat. He showed Peter how to fish before he asked him to stop fishing. And Peter let him into his boat before he left it behind. For me to live is Christ. We let Christ into our lives and we don't do all the work and work out where we're going and what our lives are about. We just simply say, Jesus, please get into my boat. And then you be the captain, you steer wherever. It might be that he just leaves you right where he found you, but no longer entangled and caught up and obsessed with the nets that you're living amongst. It would be wonderful if we all had such an attitude of abandonment where we live that if Jesus called us to lay it all down, we wouldn't skip a beat because we've already laid it all down. We wouldn't be all grasping it and saying, I can't leave this, I can't leave that. It would all be surrendered already. But however surrendered we are, every step is a risk. Putting out from the shore is a risk. Going into the deep is a risk. Walking away from your nets is a risk. Walking away in front of everybody on the beach is a risk. If you want to live a risk-free Christian life, you won't be living a Christian life. There is no risk-free Christian life. Because when it's risk-free, it's all about you. And when you're not willing to take any risks, you're basically saying to Jesus, I do not trust you. All of us have different fears. But Jesus knows that. That's why he continually says, do not be afraid. We all have our fears. And Jesus totally understands that. And sadly, a lot of us get to a place in our lives where we stop taking risks. We think we're kind of beyond all that. I've heard somebody say, you know, when you're middle-aged, when all you exercise is caution. Life's become one scary place and, you know, you've got your insurance, your life insurance, your death insurance, your car insurance. Canada's the most insured place I've been on the planet. And we're all putting everything in place to keep us safe. Who wants to be safe? If you want a life with Christ, it's an adventure. And he is the ever-present I am. So he's not pushing us out. He's saying, come to me. He's in it. He'll never call us into something where he's not. That was terrible English. But he's present. And one of our problems is we're very frightened of stepping into things because actually we're prideful. We step into things that we can control. And the minute we feel we're out of control, we don't want to do it. When we went up to Masada 2 years ago, there was a lady who was freaking out on the thing. And I thought, okay, I'll just sit on a knee. She was a lovely older lady. So I sat down and I said, you can be my mum for now. And she's like, oh, legs all wobbling underneath me. And I said, what's the matter? She said, I'm so scared. I said, what are you scared of? And she didn't answer me. I said, I'll tell you what you're scared of. You're not in control, are you? She said, no. What an epiphany for her in that moment. We're so scared when we're not in control. And what an illusion. We're not actually in control of anything. When did we think we were? When did we think we were in control of the planet, our families, our children? We're not. We are not in control. And it's such a relief when we realize we're not. And we stop trying to be in control of everything. Our nets and our boats and our houses and our families and our... And Peter stepped away from everything that he probably thought he had some control over into a world where he had no control because Jesus said so. And from this moment onwards, Peter leaves his boat and his nets and Jesus puts the keys of the kingdom in his hands to replace his fishing hooks. And the only explanation for Peter's life from this moment onwards is Jesus. That's the only explanation for his life, where he goes, where he speaks, what he does, what he doesn't do, where he spends every day, how he lives, how he dies. That doesn't mean everything is in obedience to Jesus. It certainly is not, but it's all in relationship with Jesus. It's all wrestling with Jesus. Is that your life? The only explanation for your life is Christ? Or is he just a kind of little bit? Is he like a Sunday thing? or have you recklessly abandoned your life? Apart from him, you can do nothing. Some of you spent time looking at the vine, abiding in him, totally, totally dependent on him. Peter was found by Jesus. He followed Jesus. He forsook Jesus. He let go. And he risked everything. And if Jesus had not been real, everything would have collapsed. But you'll never know if Jesus is real until you risk everything. You'll never know that. So, we find Jesus, we follow him, we forsake him, we fear him. But what happens a little bit down the road in this wonderful relationship, this euphoria of walking along the beach with Jesus? Do we keep trusting him? It was on this lake not long after this that the disciples found themselves in a storm. And I've explained to you the reasons for that. And when they were in the storm, you don't need to go there, but it's in Mark chapter 4. Jesus was actually in the boat with them, and the storm was raging all around them, and fear came back in the storm. It usually does. However much we've surrendered, when the storm hits, the fears come back, and they started to fear. And they turned to him in verse 38 of Mark 4, and they say to Jesus, who's fast asleep, "Don't you care if we drown? Don't you care if we drown?" Jesus is sleeping in the boat peacefully, and they are panicking in the storm. And they conclude, because he's not doing anything, he doesn't care. Have you reached that conclusion in your life? Doesn't he care I'm drowning? Doesn't he care about the storm? Doesn't he care? Why doesn't he do something? If he cared, he'd do something. And Jesus calmly wakes up and he stills the storm. Have you asked that question? Don't you care of the pain in my life? Don't you care of the cancer that my mum has? Don't you care the sleepless nights that I'm going through? Don't you care, Jesus? Where are you in all this? It reminds me of a time we were once on an aeroplane, and we had my son with us, and he was very little. And after we'd been flying a little while, he turned to me and he said, "Is somebody driving this plane?" He was about five. And I said, "Yeah, he is actually, Matthew. He's not driving it, he's flying it, and he's called the pilot." And he said, "Well, where is he?" I said, "Well, he's behind those doors at the front there. You can't see him, but that's okay." So we flew a bit further, and then he turned to me with still a very troubled face and very big eyes, and he said, "Does he know we're all in here?" Countries are fighting each other. There's a storm in my marriage. There's a storm in my family. You're the pilot. Are you behind the closed doors? Do you know we're all in here? And of course, he does. And the disciples had witnessed extraordinary miracles in the lives of other people, but when the storm became personal, they panicked. And most of us do that. We can see it in other people's lives, but when the storm hits us, unemployment, sickness, childlessness, marriage problems, toddler tantrums, teenage tantrums, old parent tantrums, then it doesn't seem so real anymore, and we wonder if he knows we're in the boat, if we're in the plane. And some of us not only doubt in the storm, but we doubt when things are going well because we're bracing ourselves for the storm. Surely this isn't going to last. I want to look at the disciples in another storm. This is Matthew 14. And as we've understood, storms are very familiar on this lake. The storm itself would not be frightening to them. This time Jesus is not in the boat. He's on the hillside. You can see behind the hillside. And from the hillside, you can see the lake. Last night, Charles and I were here before you. We watched you all leaving that shore. We watched all the lights come out onto the lake. We watched the boats getting close to each other. We didn't realize you were being hooked up next to each other, but we could see you all coming close. We could hear the music. We could see you, but you could not see us. And there are times that we cannot see God, but he can see us. And in this situation, Jesus could see them, but they didn't know he could see them because they couldn't see him. Matthew 14, verse 22. This is after the feeding of the 5,000. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of them to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he dismissed them, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. I wonder if it was moonlit as it was last night. And when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, here's the words again, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." And to his horror, Jesus said, "Come." Then Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and he began to sink and he cried out, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." When they'd crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret. I love this story. Here are the disciples in a storm and Jesus comes walking on the water. And notice, Peter would rather be in the storm on the water with Jesus than in the boat where it was supposedly safe without Jesus. So he's willing to get out because he trusts him, and he does a wonderfully crazy thing. He says, "Lord, if it's you, tell me to come." Remember, that's the guiding principle of his life. If it's you, bid me come. And it is Jesus. And maybe that's all we ever need to know. If it's you, bid me come. If it's you calling me into this Sunday school class, bid me come. If it's you calling me into this move into a new town, bid me come. If it's you asking me to fly across the Atlantic and take my whole family with me and begin again, bid me come. If it's you calling me into this relationship, bid me come. If it's you, bid me come. And Jesus says, "Come." And to his amazement, probably Jesus' amazement, Peter comes, but to Peter's amazement, he walks on the water. And then, you know this, it's very familiar, but the trust runs out. "You of little faith," he says in verse 31, "why did you doubt?" And that's not little faith amount. He had a lot of faith. It was little duration. He stepped out and then he stopped trusting. That's very, very easy to do. I know when we stepped out and we moved away from England, I've left my parents there, that's tough. We've moved our children away to Canada. And when we were moving, a dear friend said to me, "Hillary, if it's right now, it'll be right in 6 months' time after you've been there for that length of time." Very wise words, because in the first flush of enthusiasm and obedience, you step out and it's great and God's called us here. And then as time goes on, you begin to think, what are we doing? Did God really call us here? What have I left behind? Etc., etc. And if it's right, it's going to be right 6 months down the track. If it's right to step out of the boat, whatever the storm's like, it's still right and you can still walk on the water. But he sees the storm, and I'm sure in Peter's mind, he begins to think, this is ridiculous. Ridiculous what I'm doing. I hope your life with Jesus is ridiculous, where there's no explanation other than Christ. And he takes his eyes off Jesus. And maybe he did that because he suddenly thought, I can do this by myself. I can walk on the water. Big mistake. Takes his eyes off Jesus. He sees the storm. He doubts. But he does a very, very wise thing at this point. And I don't know if you've ever noticed it. He looks back. When he starts to sink, he looks back. And we know that because he cries out, Lord, save me. He doesn't start to sink and not know what to do. He knows he needs to look straight back to Christ. And so he does do. He looks back. And Jesus says in verse 27, take courage or be of good cheer. I am here. The ever-present I am. The need for courage is not all past. He's still in the midst of the storm. But Charles says a wonderful thing about this passage. He says that everything that threatened to be over Peter's head was under Jesus' feet. Everything that threatened to be over his head was under Jesus' feet. But the storm is still raging. And when Jesus says, come to him, he doesn't still the storm and then invite him out of the boat. He invites him to step out of the boat in the midst of the storm. And Peter does what many of us do. He swings between two extremes as he steps out of that, I can do anything in Christ, to I can't do anything in Christ. And most of us, our lives are on a pendulum like that. We have moments when we step out of boats and we have moments when we just hunker down in fear. But he sets off in obedience. And the reason he doesn't make it is because the storm suddenly becomes bigger than the Saviour. So he's seeing the storm all around him. And you know what it's like to sink, to begin to doubt. But what I love in this passage is that Jesus catches him in verse 31. He reaches out his hand, he catches him. He says, you have little faith, why did you doubt? Verse 32, and when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Jesus teaches us in the storm. If you're waiting to be taught by Jesus for the storm to all settle down around you, when it's quiet, I'll hear his voice. No. He teaches us in the storm. And so many people look at this passage and they focus on the fact that Peter took his eyes off Jesus. Yes, he did, but the storm continued to rage and he looked back and Jesus let him sink. He let him cry out. Then he caught him, then he taught him. And we are at our most teachable when we have sunk and we've allowed ourselves to be caught. And then in the storm, he teaches us. And maybe you put so much energy in your life into trying to get the storm to just settle down. But Jesus rescues us in the storm. You might have looked away, and you might still be looking away, and the storm might still be raging. And maybe God is simply saying to you this afternoon, look back. Cry out, Lord, save me. Not, Lord, still the storm, but save me in the storm. And then we get to verse 32 and the storm is over. And in the boat, we are told, verse 33, those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. But do you know something? The disciples in the boat worshipped Jesus with dry hair. And Peter worshipped with wet hair. Because he had sunk and allowed Christ to save him. Are you a disciple with dry hair who is so intent on staying in the boat and keeping everything safe? And it's Peter who has the real relationship with Christ. It's Peter who Christ continually leads another step because he risks and discovers Jesus is exactly who he says he is. Peter's the one with wet hair. Peter's the one who took the risk. Peter's the one who gets out of the boat, who doesn't just watch other people being rescued, but is actually himself rescued. And it's Peter who goes on to be a rescuer. In the Acts of the Apostles, it's Peter who the day he stands up and preaches his first sermon, thousands of people are rescued. Why? Because he's allowed himself to be rescued. And Jesus will one day say to Peter, look after my sheep, rescue my lambs. And he would never, ever have done that in Peter's life if Peter hadn't stepped out of that boat and allowed Christ to rescue him. But the whole sheep thing is another story, and we'll go there tomorrow. I don't know where you are right now in this story. I don't know if you're on the beach. I don't know if you're hugging the shore. I don't know if you're daring to go out into the deep. I don't know if you're out in the deep and now you're just clinging to the boat again. I don't know if you're waiting the storm to die down. I don't know if you actually stepped out and now you're sinking because you're of little faith. It gave up when it got too rough for you. But wherever you are in all this, the first step is to look back. It's so simple. To restore eye contact with Christ. He looks at us. And we need to look back at him and affirm to him, you are Lord. You are Lord. You called me into this. You called me along the shore. You called me out of the boat. You're Lord. You're still Lord, however dark it may look. You know, when we allow ourselves to be rescued in the storm, not to try and go round it, but to actually go through it, we discover at the heart of the storm, at the heart of pain, at the heart of sorrow, the man of sorrows. The man of sorrows who lived his life in a storm, always a storm raging around Christ, and he was asleep in the boat because he only did those things that pleased the Father. He knew who he was, he knew what he was doing, he knew where he was going, and like the branch with the vine, he lived in complete dependence on God. Why was he up in the hills praying while his disciples were tossing around on the lake? Because he needed his Heavenly Father. He spent all night in prayer before he chose his disciples. He continually drew aside. And we don't. And he was the Son of God, and he depended on his Father for his every move. I only do those things that please the Father. Are you blocking the view? Did you think it was all about you? It's not. It's all about Christ. And I know some of you are hearing his voice. In his loving, patient way, he's saying, leave your nets and follow me. You don't have to know where every step is going to lead. You just need to take the first step of surrender. And if God has been whispering to you, leave your nets and come. It might be time to leave the hugging the shore life that you're living. It might be time to get out of the boat. It might be time to discover that Jesus rescues us in the storm.
To watch this message again, go to our website, livingtruth.ca. You can also order DVDs and CDs, download transcripts, sign up for our monthly newsletter, check out the Living Truth Daily Devotional, sign up for podcasts, and read faith stories from other viewers. We love to hear from you, so send us your comments and testimonies. Living Truth is supported by viewers like you. Thank you for transforming lives through your financial participation.
Join us next week for more free biblical teaching on Living Truth.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for
with my soul together.
It is well with
my sin.
Oh, the bliss of this glorious thought.
Church.